Hello, you are Chen Real Books, and today we'll give you some pieces of advice how to actually help yourself by helping others. So first, let's define what helping others really means. Probably the first thing that comes to mind when you think about it is financial aid. Somehow, many people are convinced that one should be extremely rich to provide others with help. But the whole thing isn't about huge donations to charities or adopting children from developing countries. There are many things you can use to make someone's life a little or a lot easier except money. Your time, ideas, skills, attention, care, and even something as slight as a mere smile will make a difference to the world around you. Small and simple acts of kindness mean as much, if not more, than loud and spectacular ones. Now that you know of the significance of any help, you may be struggling to come up with particular ideas. Don't worry, there are more ways of helping others than there are stars in the night sky, and most of them are seemingly inconsequential acts of thoughtfulness. Here are some small steps which will be useful if you are determined to take action right now. Donate unused furniture and clothes you never wear. You will deal with the clutter, organize your space, and find a good use for things you don't need anymore without just throwing them away. Call your friends, parents, and loved ones to ask how they are doing. Help an old lady cross the street. Cook dinner and bring it to someone who has been ill or experienced a tough time. Do some volunteering. Time spent on a community service will become a great contribution to the common welfare. Hold an open door or an elevator. Start cleaning up a beach or a park. People will see it and follow your example. Share your knowledge. For example, you can give a few English lessons for free or show how to knit. Give a ride for someone in a hurry. Participate in a local blood donation campaign. Express your positive emotions and gratitude to people surrounding you. Tell someone how much you appreciate them or send a text message. Check in on an elderly person and help them to get something fixed or suggest making an appointment with a doctor if there is such a need. And last but not the least, hug someone just to brighten their day. Remember, it costs 0 cents to be a nice person, so don't take too long and find the strength to change the future within yourself. What is the importance of helping others? All of us want to get ahead in life and lead it to its full potential. It's impossible to do so if we underestimate the importance of helping others. The implications of your concern are likely to be far-reaching in the minds and memories of those you interact with, having its own unique set of rewards that can be purchased at any cost. There can be no doubt that you will gain a nice reputation and stand out from the crowd for demonstrating your care. Every time you communicate with other people, being observant and proactive in your help-focused objective, numerous opportunities will be presented, even if you perform plain acts of courtesy. Just the offer of assistance will open up many possibilities, illuminating the doorway of friendship and boosting your self-confidence. Think of life as a mirror. What you reflect and give out to others, it will also get back, often multiplied million times over. What are some health benefits of being helpful? We have covered the psychological side of the advantages of helping others. Now let's talk about the physical aspect. Among the most obvious profits are stress decrease. Lower anxiety levels and keep yourself active by offering to do yard work for those who are not able to do it by themselves. Longer life. Donating blood reduces the risk of heart attack and stroke and has been linked to an increased lifespan. You may also bring a trash bag and pick up litter next time you go for a walk to create a cleaner environment and prevent cardiovascular diseases. Improved mental health. Delivering groceries or medications for someone in need will lessen loneliness and minimize exposure to depression, thus making you feel happier and more satisfied. Now let's talk about how to soothe someone who feels sad. Sometimes it is hard to understand when a person in front of you looks heartbroken or troubled. Doing good deeds is one thing, but supporting people when they are down in the dumps in the right way is another. You should be prepared to do your best here, because often we lack all the skills to deliver on our positive intentions. It's crucial to recognize an old, largely unmentioned phenomenon, how varied our notions of help can be. We might be types who, when we divulge our agonies, our priority may just be to hear that everything will eventually be okay, even with a little bit of exaggeration. For us, love is hope. Or alternatively, it's hope that may be irritating. What calms us down is a quiet talk around the prospect of catastrophe. We long for someone to explore the grimmest possibilities and be honest enough to see the dangers and to worry about them as much as we do. Differently again, when we are sad or in difficulties, need first and foremost to speak. All that matters is someone sitting with us at length and listen. We want them to signal their engagement with their eyes, to register our anger, to observe our disappointment, and to prompt us with a small supportive sound. Yet what we absolutely don't want, answers, solutions, or analysis, because the real problem we need assistance with isn't so much the specific issue we are mentioning. It's the overarching sense that most people we encounter can't be really bothered with our problems. Then again, at another end of the spectrum, love might not feel real unless it's accompanied by precise and concrete actions. We might want to hear a flow of ideas as to what we should do next, whom we might call, and how we can get answers. A cuddle can sound to some like a pet response to bad news, but for us, it can be the most reliable evidence of heartfelt love. To help our minds, we need someone first to reassure our bodies while we close our eyes in pain and surrender to their firm embrace. Recognizing that there are different styles of help at least alerts us to the severe risks of misunderstanding. Instead of getting annoyed at inept and sometimes wildly misdirected efforts, we can grasp the basic truth that these are actually the attempts to be nice. Now let's talk about altruism. Is it a self-denial or a part of a human nature? Altruism is another way to say helping others and means acting in the best interests of people rather than in one's own self-interest. Some believe that altruism constitutes the essence of morality. A person who helps others selflessly and has a passion for helping others may be called an altruist. Although we often act egotistically, we also seem to be wired to cooperate with others. For example, studies show that when people look for mates, they tend to look for kindness more than any other quality. People's moral judgments are often driven by emotion, and empathy for others seems to encourage altruism, which builds social connections as well and stimulates us to establish strong relationships. But the question about the nature of altruism has been stumping scientists for years. Charles Darwin studied beehives and realized that natural selection might favor altruism within related groups, since bees were helping their blood relatives, especially the queen, but still considered altruism to be a flaw that could ruin his theory of natural selection. It couldn't possibly favor a behavior that made us less likely to survive. In 1964, 100 years later after that, a British scientist named William Hamilton figured that the genes responsible for altruistic behavior could evolve if its benefit exceeded whatever cost it had for the individual because it helped their relatives enough to make it worthwhile. However, this idea did not explain why some animals help others that they're not even related to. Humans, for example, are deeply social animals, also exceptionally altruistic. A lot of scientists think that humans evolved our smart brains in response to the overwhelming profits of engaging in selfless behavior. But if you delve into it, you can see a self-serving basement behind that altruism evolution. But if you delve into it, you can see a self-serving basement behind the altruism evolution. We help each other because we expect the same in return. Hamilton's theory does not clarify such twist. But despite the lack of the scientific grounds, if you can cooperate with others and resist the urge to hoard resources, knowing you'll be awarded later, you'll be acting a lot like bees. Another emotion, called elevation, appears to inspire altruistic behavior too. It is a word for feeling good about helping others, and we also experience it when we see another person acting virtuously. So, while altruism leads us to do what's best for others, it also makes us feel good in the process and can claim to be a part of human nature, yet research has yet to confirm it. There is also another kind of people addicted to helping others, philanthropists. The word philanthropy comes from the Greek philo, which means friend, and if you translate it directly, it is love for mankind or caring about your community. We'll tell you about some outstanding individuals who dedicated themselves to philanthropy and who serve as great examples of helping others. They can also inspire you to write a role model essay. The first one is Michael Bloomberg. 2 months after 9/11 attacks, this man was elected mayor of New York City and served for the next 11 years. He's become well known for his charity group Bloomberg Philanthropies, which centers on 5 key areas: public health, the arts, government innovation, environment, and education, essentially the foundation for a progressive America. The second is Andrew Carnegie. Upon moving to the United States from his native Scotland in 1948, an adolescent Andrew Carnegie nabbed his first job and realized the potential in his new land. Along came the Industrial Revolution, and he is one of the men who truly shaped the country. Carnegie amassed a fortune that he continuously pumped back into the economy. Andrew set the standard for billionaire philanthropists, as he donated approximately 90% of his earnings to New America. And the following are Bill and Melinda Gates. Bill Gates was a co-founder of Microsoft, and he's long been on record about his admiration for Andrew Carnegie, along with David Rockefeller. With the American forefathers serving as his model for philanthropy, Bill and his wife Melinda formed the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation in 2000, which is undoubtedly the 21st century model for all major philanthropists. They have graciously donated nearly $30 billion to charity as of 2013. Moreover, in a new digital world, Bill and Melinda Gates are able to effectively organize the world's most influential moguls to promote a better way of life across the globe. Let's sum it all up with touching quotes to give thought to. Great opportunities to help others seldom come, but small ones surround us every day. Sally Koch. He who sows the most reaps the most. Jim Rohn. Life engenders life. Energy creates energy. It is by spending oneself that one becomes rich. Sarah Bernhardt. The meaning of life is to find your gift. The purpose of life is to give it away. Pablo Picasso. So that was all. Thanks for watching.